So Shanta and I are going to cover behavioral research, but our focus is going to be thinking on how can we apply behavioral research, audit behavioral research in a information systems environment. So what are some of the things that research that has been done, and what are some of the factors that we should consider as we're developing experiments for behavioral research? And so what's important, most of the behavioral research, well, all of it that I'm going to refer to, that we're going to talk about, is going to be about audit research. And so if auditor behavioral research related to accounting to auditors isn't new, or to accounting information systems isn't new. There's always been research that's looked at how auditors interact with decision aids, how they interact with decision support systems, and looking at how it impacts their judgment and decision making. So I'm going to approach it from that perspective, the audit JDM research. So I was going to give just an overview of what we mean when we're talking about auditor judgment and decision making, and then talk a bit more about the qualities of good decision making and good judgment, and then try to talk a little bit about some of the research that's been done by some of our former PhD students and current PhD students that's utilizing the auditor judgment and decision making framework to examine how auditors use information technology. Yes.
So I just have a broad question that I was thinking about when I was reading through some of this. Obviously, a lot of this behavioral research relies on psychology research.
Yes.
Are there any examples where traditional psychology research dictates one set of behaviors, but is in a business environment, the behavior is dramatically different?
So I can't think of any off the top of my head, but with respect to that, where auditors might behave differently because of the context, there's been research that shows where an auditor might make a decision, whereas the psych literature would suggest that you make decisions in a particular way, or you approach decisions in a particular way, auditors might approach that differently. I can't think of any off the top of my head. But overall, I think the majority of the research shows that drawing on that psych literature is appropriate because auditors are individuals, right? So we make, biases that individuals are subjected to, we're subjected to as auditors, right? Because we're human beings and we process information as human beings. We have limitations on our cognitive ability and our memory, right? Overall, the research has shown that auditors behave the same way. The consequences of those decisions are very different in an audit context, right? I have done most of my research on auditor-client negotiations, right? So the negotiation literature, for example, is drawn from, the theory is based on the general negotiation literature. Well, we're finding that auditors approach it the same way, but the consequences are different, right? A lot of the literature might use, let's say, students negotiating over a car or something like that, right? You or I could walk away from that car deal. And there's really no consequence to it, right? If we walk away or we reach an impasse, there's no consequence. But in an audit setting, there's a real consequence, and because of that consequence, it changes how they approach it, right? So that I know that's not necessarily drawn on directly on psych, but that's an example. But because of the consequence of the context that we find ourselves in as auditors, it might change how we approach or how we make that decision. So there's that real, very hardcore psych in terms of information processing, cognitive abilities,
how the brain works.
That's going to be, it doesn't matter, right, whether it's an auditor or not.
My question comes, like, that makes sense to me, and I didn't really think of that, but also my question comes more from the thought that, like, if I'm conducting a psychology test, I'm drawing a sample of the general population,
mm-hmm.
but maybe auditors have different characteristics that make them auditors in the first place that
right.
may cause them to react differently in the same situation.
Right, so, and in general, you would try to control for those things, right? Or at least try to determine, well, how might that change how they would approach it? So we might not get the same outcome, right, that if you ran that experiment in a general population. But I also suggest that most of the experiments that we're running or questions that were you would never ask of the general population anyway, right? Because you have to have a certain level of expertise to be an auditor. That's why, you know, we sit here and sit for the CPA exam and so forth and so on, right? So what we're really doing with the experiment is we're saying we're drawing on these theories that psychosis. So one that I'll go over, you know, later on today is, you know, there's this, auditors exhibit this overconfidence, right? And because of overconfidence, they might not, they will rush to solve or not really fully look for disconfirming, they look to confirm or things like that. Well, that's what people do. That's a bias that most individuals have, right? But in an audit context, it's the outcome of it is different. And so the training, so hopefully to help inform training, right, we would, you know, probably train an auditor, we would train an auditor very differently to overcome that bias than we might train somebody, you know, negotiating for a car. So I just think the way we process information doesn't necessarily change because we're an auditor. The consequences of it is different. Does that help?
Yeah.
All right, so I can't remember, this is like the third time I'm doing a JDM lecture overview this semester, so I apologize for redundancies, but I can only make it as different from the last lecture as possible, but it's the context of, you know, the information we want to cover is basically the same. Okay, why do I keep having a problem here? All right. Okay, so when we talk about judgment and decision making, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with auditing or work as an auditor, but we talked about the auditing context. One of the critical things in the audit context is the fact that there's a lot of judgment and decision making that's involved in auditing. And auditing involves a high level of judgment at various degrees of judgment or complexity, I should say. So you could have, you know, something that is very structured, right? So for example, if an auditor has to, you know, evaluate internal controls, right? So evaluate whether or not the control is operating. Right, that's a really simple, right? Because we have a set of rules of what those internal controls are, and it's a simple, did they violate the control or not, right? So there's not a high level of judgment with respect to that, or the effectiveness of those controls. So effectiveness over control, for the internal controls over the shipping process, right? To much more complex judgments, such as judgments related to assessing the fair value of financial instruments that are level 2 or level 3, right? That they have no ready market. So it's much more complex. So the going concern decision, right? It's much more complex because there's so much uncertainty involved in those judgments, right? There's uncertainty involved in the situation or the factors that have led to having to make that type of judgment. So you take going concern for an instance, right? That's not a judgment that auditors have to make all the time. right? Because most, if the majority of companies are able to continue as a going concern. So it's quite possible that auditors never really, or very, you know, not very often are they confronted with the situation where their client might be facing a going concern issue. And so all of the things that they have to consider, for example, is the company going to be able to get funding? Will that funding be enough, right? Those are things that are surrounded by uncertainty, because most times that a company's facing a going concern issue, they're trying to deal with that issue in the current space, right? That they're trying to, they're talking to investors, they're talking to lenders to try to get the funding available. Risk assessment is another complex judgment that auditors have to make, not as highly complex as, say, fair value measurement, but it's still a judgment where there's uncertainty, right? Again, the auditor has to assess the inherent risk. They have to assess the risk of material misstatement. So they have to look at all those factors and come up with some type of assessment about whether or not that risk will result in a material misstatement or create a higher likelihood of a material misstatement. And it's also one of those types of things that all of us can look at the same set of factors, right, and come up with a very different determination. Whereas if we look at a set of factors around internal controls, right, I think we can all pretty much agree on whether or not that control was violated. Right? It's more, that's a less structured task. So the audit environment, also GAAP, right? GAAP, General Accepted Accounting Principles, while we're rules-based, there are a number of elements of GAAP that's not, right? That's very principle-oriented, that requires judgment, that's subjective. Something as simple as the allowance for doubtful accounts, right? The allowance for doubtful accounts is an estimate. You have no idea. You're trying to make a decision about something that could happen. You're trying to allow for a reserve based on some factors that suggest that there's a likelihood that this percentage of the accounts receivable will be uncollectible. Right? There's uncertainty around that. And so GAAP doesn't say, oh, you know, here's how you can, you know, here's what it should be. GAAP says you should allow for the fact that you're not going to collect 100% of your receivables. You should allow for the fact that you're going to have inventory that's obsolete. You're not going to turn all your inventory over. And an auditor now has to come in and look at management's estimates about that, right? And make a determination about whether or not it's fairly presented. So just the nature of GAAP requires or puts auditors in a position where they have to evaluate estimates and judgments. So this is straight from the site literature, your judgment process is going to be influenced by your knowledge, your task-specific versus general domain. And so when I talk about task-specific, I mean that you have experience with a particular task. So for example, if you notice that accounting firms are aligned along industry, right? So let's say, for example, that I gave with fair value measurement. So people who are auditors on financial services companies, right? They are people who have industry expertise or task experience with that particular task of fair value measurement, right? Or auditing companies in the financial services industry. Right, what auditors have done when you're in a environment where you have that expertise, where you're only auditing, or the majority of your clients are in the financial services industry, you're developing knowledge about that industry that someone just coming from, let's say, manufacturing is not going to have that, right? Because you see something over and over. You know the challenges in that particular industry. You know where the risks are. You understand how the transactions are generated in that industry, right? So you have task-specific experience. As a first-year auditor or staff auditor, you will probably have past experience auditing internal controls. Because it's what you do. You're going to walk off, and that's what you're going to do, because they'll do internal controls for the most part. Versus general domain experience, that you understand auditing. Right? You understand assertions, you know what the objectives are. Yeah, you can audit cash, right? Yes, you can audit accounts receivable. You have general knowledge about auditing. Like, there's some basic things you just know how to do because you've been trained to do that as a part of the overall, your overall training. Experience is not expertise. Right? Experience means, okay, I have, I worked in auditing. Between external and internal auditing, I probably worked in auditing for about 15 years, right? So I have experience in auditing, but I also believe that I have an expertise in auditing, right? Because it's what I do, right? It's what I've spent the majority of my career doing, both as a private industry, but also as a researcher and as an educator, right? So I believe I have expertise. Audit. Now, is my expertise as great as somebody who's still in auditing? Probably not, but I understand the lingo. I have general accounting experience. Right? I'm never going to go and close financial statements. That's just not what I do. I understand it. I could probably do it. I don't want to do it, but I have experience in accounting. I understand accounting. I understand what it takes to close a set of financial statements, but I don't have expertise in that. I couldn't go into, let's say financial services is my thing, but I couldn't go into a bank. Like, my best friend is the senior vice president of this capital markets company or bank, of this bank in a capital markets group. And to hear what she goes through to close her books every month and certainly every year, and she's complaining to me, so I get the basics. I can figure out the debits and credit, but I could never close her books. I could never, because I just don't, it's like, oh my God, the books would never be closed. But I understand accounting. I understand the debits and credits. I can figure it out. So I have experience, and there's a difference. And expertise is that you have this ingrained knowledge, a much higher level of knowledge about a particular industry, a particular task. It's also going to be influenced by your cognitive abilities, your intelligence, that kind of goes without saying, right? How we process information, what our problem-solving skills are. So those are all things that will influence your judgment. And then decision making, and we always use this term like it's all one term, judgment and decision making. Right? When we, researchers, we're really bad at it. We're doing JDM research. Well, we analyze a person's judgment, see what factors impact their judgment, knowledge, experience, cognitive ability, skills, and then how that then translates to the decisions that they make, how that judgment impacts their decision. So a decision is choosing between alternatives, options or alternatives, right? If you don't have any options or alternatives, you're not making a decision, right? So that goes without saying. So I know we always have this debate. Let's have this debate with people who do archival capital markets research. And wondering is auditing really a research area? Is auditing really just, it's just accounting? And I would say that auditing research is extremely important when you consider the role of auditors in the capital markets, right? So the role of auditors are in the capital markets, they serve as a monitor, especially for publicly held companies, right? Because there's a reason that a company has to file their finance, they cannot file with the SEC without having an audit opinion, without having audited financial statements. Like when we look at financial statements, when a company, especially if we're trying to make a decision about whether or not we want to invest in that company, when we make that decision, one of the more important things we're going to look at are the audited financial statements. We're going to look at the audit opinion. Like the audit opinion, and there's been tons of research on the expectation gap, right? The audit opinion is what people look at as a pass or fail. It means something if the company has an unqualified or clean opinion, right? It's like a check mark, they passed, right? Versus if they have an adverse opinion, it matters. If audits didn't matter, then why is it that if a company has to restate, it impacts their stock price? Or if there's an audit failure, why, if auditors don't matter, then why sue the auditors, right? Because you relied on the opinion that they gave. So audit judgments are important. So the financial statement also, one of the approach that I think most audit researchers take, that we take, is that the audit, the financial statements are a joint outcome of the auditor and management. So management obviously is the first mover, the financial statements belong to management, it's their responsibility to prepare the financial statements, but before those financial statements can be released to the public, if they're a publicly held company, they have to be audited. And so when you consider that there's joint inputs, not that the auditors are coming up with the numbers, but they're auditing those numbers, right? And so they're going to help drive what's reported in the financial statements. And that's kind of the thought process with auditor-client negotiation, is that the auditors and clients are negotiating over issues that are ambiguous and subjective to determine what should really be reported in the financial statements. So you could imagine that if auditors are not good at that negotiation process, like if they constantly concede to their clients, right, then those financial statements are not going to make, perhaps doesn't reflect the true value of the company's financial position. And we're seeing more emphasis on this after the recent, recent economic crisis. Look at all of the laws or regulatory standards that have been placed on audit profession or auditors as a result of the WorldComs and the Enron, right? Because you have to restore public trust in the audit profession. There's greater scrutiny. And another reason that is also important is because they're now, as we move more and more to incorporating fair value as opposed to historical cost in the financial statements, what is it about fair value? What's the difference between those types of measurements and historical cost? What's the key difference? Fair value measurement, yes, Jamie.
Fair value is it like a difference in judgment?
But it requires a lot of judgment. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely right. Right? Historical cost is this is what I paid for it, and this is what it's on the books at. And if it's an asset such as property, plant, and equipment, right, we're going to depreciate it. I come up with a depreciation method. Record that on the balance sheet as accumulated depreciation, take the expense. That's easy, right? Historical cost is easy. This is what I paid for, here's what it's worth because I've depreciated. Fair value isn't, especially fair value where there's not a ready market, or fair value that involves trying to come up with whether goodwill is impaired, right? There's a significant amount of judgment involved in it. And if you remember during the time leading up to right after the Enrons and the WorldComs and the SEC was really, like, companies are exploiting the subjectivity and gap to manage their earnings, right? So if Because what a, you know, auditors are not the police. Right? So we don't have policing. They don't have policing power. So they could go into their client and say, you know, you recorded this fair value estimate at X. We think it should be Y. The client's gonna come back and say, show me where GAAP tells me it should be X. Right? GAAP, I'm well within the bounds of GAAP. GAAP says that I have to do, you know, estimate this. Here's the process that I use to estimate it. Here are the inputs that I use and the assumptions that I made. So you tell me why this is wrong. Because GAAP doesn't tell me that. They can push back. Right? And so that's where also the importance of having experience and expertise is so important. Because auditor, especially knowing your client's industry or having expertise in a particular industry, because now if you can bring in, you know, a knowledge store of what other companies are doing, data in a sense, from other sources to help support your arguments that you make to your client. Right? So just having that increased subjectivity through fair value measurement, there's greater judgment. And so there's so much that occurs because in this context of uncertainty and risk. So the audit is very much a risk-based approach. So in auditing, when we look at our audit research, when we're looking at judgment and decision making, we look at three broad areas: evaluation of evidence. And we're going to talk about that a little bit when we talk about some of the things that we can do with audit analytics. Accounting estimates, which I talked about, such as inventory, obsolescence, allowance for doubtful accounts, fair value measurement, estimating probabilities, such as going concern or risk material misstatement, and deciding between options, such as extending your audit test versus not. Right, so let's say, for example, you come up with, right now, traditional audit approaches that we use statistical sampling. And so we examine, once we, you know, use statistical sampling, select a sample of items or transactions to look at, and let's just say they fall outside, that the exception rate is higher than our tolerable exceptions, right, that we're willing to accept. So now the auditor has to decide whether or not they can extend their audit proof test, meaning get more evidence, or do they just say, no, this is a material misstatement. We're not gonna extend our test because we don't know that extending the test is gonna change this opinion or this outcome, so therefore, we're just gonna qualify, or we're gonna call this a material misstatement, or material weakness in internal controls. So those are the three broad areas that involves JDO. I talked about this briefly, so I don't go in there. Level one, so one of the things that we looked at in a project that we were doing, Michelos, Andrea now, Denise at one point, and myself, looking at verbal protocol analysis. And what we were doing was we were looking at the risk assessment process, the planning risk assessment process. We were thinking, well, how would we characterize the risk assessment process? What's the level of judgment? So clearly it's not structured, right? Because there are too many factors that you consider. And as I said, if it's a situation where we can all look at the same set of factors and come out with totally different risk assessments, then it's not structured, right? You're structured, you're gonna have minimal judgment, such as cutoff, right? Did they ship the goods, yes or no, right? If they shipped them before 12/31 or on 12/31, then we could record the revenue. If they didn't, we can't. There's no real judgment there. So it's an easier decision process, whereas level two, semi-structured, is repetitive. There's a moderate level of judgment. There's high level of agreement among experts on the best approach. Internal control risk assessment will fall in that. And the reason that internal control risk assessment will fall in that is because internal control risk is, you do have, when you're looking at or assessing internal control risk, right, you are looking at what the client's control system of internal controls looks like. What are the key aspects of their or key controls in that system? Like, does it, and are those controls sufficient to prevent or detect a material misstatement? Right? But you have this basic guideline. So, for example, if we're evaluating internal controls related to revenue recognition or recording revenue, and let's just say we're in an environment where the client sells goods to customers. And so if the a standard control, common control that you would expect to see, is that revenue is recorded when goods are shipped, right? So then what you're gonna look at is to evaluate that control, what kind of controls the client have in place to ensure that revenue is only recorded when goods are shipped, right? So you have a template to examine that against, right? Because you know you're gonna need to see shipping documents. You know you're going to need to be able to verify that the goods are not recorded before they're shipped, that you can look at the dates that items are updated in the sales journal, that there are controls over the shipping document, that it's pre-numbered, and so forth and so on. Right? So there are these a set of factors that you can look at to determine whether or not that control is effective. So your understanding of what generates or what good controls look like with respect to revenue recognition means that we probably, if we all look at those same facts, we're probably gonna come up with, you know, a consensus on whether or not that control is effective. Whereas level three is more unstructured tasks. It's highly subjective. There's a high level of judgment. Reaching consensus is not always feasible, such as going concern. And most of the times you will see these types of issues being considered more complex. And when I think about a risk assessment, inherent risk assessment, I think, is probably more unstructured than internal control risk assessment. Because inherent risk assessment would be things like management tone at the top, management's, attitude toward financial reporting, management's attitude toward, you know, analyst following and things like that, or the company is, you know, no longer, they have a product that's no longer on patent, you know, it's off patent. So what kind of, you know, how does that impact how the company now approaches revenue recognition, things like that. So those, that's a little less structured than having a template of what good controls are, right, and measuring those controls against that template. Fair value would definitely fall into that because of the complexity of fair value measurement of level two and three assets. And the example here is going concern, right? Going concern, maybe. So we like to think about judgment in that way. So most times, JDM research is really looking at those more unstructured type of decisions, right, or judgments, such as level two and level three type judgments, right? Because that's where you're probably going to see biases or ability impact that judgment. So one of the ways that the research on audit, JDM research, has really looked at the auditor, the audit task, and the interpersonal interactions of the auditor. So that's how we would define in terms of what's been studied in the JDM research so far. So when we talk about auditor attributes, some of the things I talked about before, auditor experience, their knowledge, their expertise, cognitive limitations, and from there's from an information technology perspective, you know, there's been research that looks at how auditors use decision aids, whether it is an automated decision aid, such as an expert system, or it's a manual decision aid, such as a checklist, right? A checklist is a decision aid. And so the researchers looked at that. What makes them susceptible to biases? So for example, there's been some research that's shown, and this is whether auditors use manual decision aids, where they over-rely on the decision aid. So it causes them to engage in a type of a confirmation bias, right? That they're just, checking the box. Like they're not thinking outside of the box. They're just making sure that those attributes have been met, right? So it impacts, it could have a negative impact on their judgment. Audit tasks, you think of any audit tasks that auditors have done. So obviously, internal control has been a huge area of research on auditor internal controls, risk assessment, their risk assessments, the audit risk related to the audit risk model, so audit planning decisions. Another huge area has been analytical procedures and evidence evaluation, right? Because again, at the end of the day, the auditor has to provide evidence to support their opinion. So evidence evaluation is hugely important. Auditors' decisions regarding whether to, waive or book or waive decisions, right? So when do they require a client to book an adjustment versus when are they willing to waive the adjustment? There's also been a good deal of research on going concern judgments. And because, again, that is considered one of the more unstructured task that auditors have to engage in. And also because it's not something, it's just like fraud risk assessment. Fraud risk assessments are very complex, right? Even though we have the fraud triangle, it's still very complex because of fraudulent financial reporting, right? Auditors have to assess whether or not there's a higher likelihood that the client is engaging in fraudulent financial reporting. And so that's where inherent risk factors become really important to assess as well. So fraud risk assessment is another area that's where there's been a lot of research, JDM research on fraud risk assessments. So all of these things that I'm talking about, as I'm saying, you should think about what if we had a tool to, an information technology tool as a decision support or decision aid to help auditors. So we'll talk about that in a moment. And then interpersonal interactions, well, what do auditors do? They interact with their clients, they interact with each other, they interact with regulators, they interact with the board of directors. So how do these interpersonal interactions impact the auditor? They don't work in isolation. And how does it impact their judgments? So jurors, right? One of the things that auditors have to keep doing, auditors have deep pockets, right? So they have to think about what's their engagement risk, what's their litigation risk, when they're, and then obviously their objective is to keep that risk low. And so how does that impact how they approach making judgments and decisions, impact their judgment and then their ultimate decision process? So what do you think some of, if you were looking for characters of someone who demonstrated effective judgment and decision-making characteristics, what are some of the characteristics you would point out as someone who displays good judgment?
Think about some of the things you might be thinking about when you go to the
decision. Jamie?
Like relatively unbiased.
Unbiased, then?
An approach to systematic thinking in what way?
Rational, systematic thinking. What else?
How do you develop that systematic thinking, right? You have to think of certain things, right?
So what would be considered a rational, systematic thinking? What do you think? So give me an example in your real life. Cyber where you think rationally or you take a systematic approach to
prioritize the many of those things and or putting the weight into the various things.
When you're making a decision. So if you're making a decision about do I continue to work this weekend or do I take my spouse out for a nice dinner? So I have to make this deadline, but I've been neglecting my spouse. So then we put some weights to that, right? And then what? So let's say you put some weights to that, and staying at work takes up. Staying at work gets a higher weight. Would you stay at work?
Yes.
Yeah. And then what's the consequence of that? He comes home with either, well, he's a PhD student, so he can only come home with flowers, no diamonds at this point.
Right,
right, you're trying to come up with a way to adjust for that.
It makes me think of when deciding to go back to school to get a PhD, right? To get all those alternatives, like if I do this, you know, I'll make less money for this period of time. But the overall quality of life throughout my life is going to go up. So you're like making those choices. But you have to consider those alternatives before you move on.
And that's actually a good point, right? Because Sean points out, because it's different for each of us who made that decision, right? So we're all going to go back for the same amount of time, for the most part, within reason, right? We're all going to go back. But it depends on where you are at your life. So if there's somebody who has, like when I went back, I didn't have a spouse and I don't have children. So my decision was all about me, right? I didn't have to consider, the only thing I had to consider was the financial aspect of it. I'm giving up X amount of dollars and this is what I'm gonna lose over a 5-year period. And when I went back, I was older. I wasn't as young as Shanta. So I, you know, so that changes. Even though Shanta is single, right, and she doesn't have kids, those factors were very similar about us, right? When we decided to go back, we were both single and we didn't have children. So we made the decision about us. The difference was where we were in our careers. Like Shanta went back earlier in her career than I went back, and so. I was giving up a lot more because of where I was in my career.
It was relatively poor, so it was
fine. Right, right. At first, but in a shorter window, right, to grow it back, right. Those are the things you weigh. So, you know, we came up with the same decision. We both decided to go back to school and get our PhD, so we put, you know, possibly weights at different places.
Or even, I guess for some of you guys, what made you decide to get a PhD in AIS or accounting or economics or finance or some of the particular departments that might be similar, right? Because I know for me, there wasn't a lot of options in terms of delineating between auditing, accounting, AIS, until you got into a specific program. But as you know, industry progressed, you know, there are some programs like this one that kind of delineates between AIS, accounting, so you have to put different weights now, not only on do I go for a PhD, but which PhD. Hopefully, since you're here, you realize there wasn't that much.
And money, you know, and some people might say money wasn't a factor for them. Right? It was very much a factor for me. But also, I wanted to do something that I enjoyed and what I felt like I had an expertise in. So my approach to it was, okay, I really enjoy auditing because I'm not leaving because I don't like auditing in accounting. I'm leaving because I don't want to be a corporate member. But also, I felt like this is something that I feel like for me, it was a confidence boost because I'm bringing a a certain skill set, like an expertise and knowledge that I have developed over the number of years that I've worked, that I can now apply this to a research setting and make a nice transition from one career to another. And so those are all of it. So that could be, we took this logical approach to deciding to go back, right, to school. But that's a characteristic, right? When you're making a judgment, you want to be logical about it. You don't want to be, you don't want to be like what we currently have.
Cavalier emotional.
Cavalier tweeting emotional person, right, making decisions. Right, so you want to be, okay, that'll be my only reference. You want to be logical about it, and you want to be unbiased, right? And that's particularly important for an auditor, right? Because they have to approach their audit with an attitude of professional skepticism, an attitude with a questioning mind. And that suggests unbiased, that you're unbiased. And that's not as easy as it sounds, right? So think about an auditor. What are some of the things that challenges their ability to be unbiased? And then how can IT or systems help address that issue? Or can it?
The biggest threat, I think, is the familiarity. So
familiar, being familiar with the client?
Or the area, so
right.
Just take a look and skip it without dipping, looking the whole
right.
data. So
right. So
by using the computer, yeah, we can just automatically filtering out.
Right, so it takes a, right, okay. So it makes it, by using information systems, what you're saying is that we can kind of address that familiarity bias by programming, you know, this the appropriate steps or filters. It has to be consistent and reliable. So that given the same set of facts, the same situation, you make that same determination, right? All things being equal, right? Same set of facts. You make that same determination. And what auditors have to also be aware of, and what they're always mindful of, is there's always someone looking over their shoulder, especially for audits of publicly held companies, PCLD, right? You want to be able to appropriately balance your judgment with your knowledge and your experience. I don't know, and intuition, there's some amount of intuition. I would think you'd want to keep emotion out of it. but, you know, and you're gonna develop intuition, that's the expertise, that's the smell test almost, right? Like you know, like for a real life example, I recently had a ride in the car. I'm one of these people who keeps my car until it falls apart. And so it was a very dramatic thing for me, because I didn't want a car now. So I exhausted like many hours agonizing over which, I knew which car I was gonna get, but going to different dealers. And so I consider myself quite knowledgeable because I was actually getting the same car, just an updated, more recent model that I been driving for the last 12 years. And so I knew it, you know, the car was, that was the easy part. The next part was then finding a deal. And because I am an accountant, I like a deal. And so, which is, you know, when you go to buy a car, it's not a good thing. And so I went into this, so I had a certain expectation about what I expected, and also based on my prior experience dealing with this particular, the dealers or makers of this car, I had a particular expectation. Well, I walked into this dealer because, you know, I found a car that I liked that they had. I found it online and I went in. The minute I walked in, this is not going to be good. It's not going to be good. That was my intuition. Like, it wasn't, I mean, it was this. You know, the dealership was the same brand, same car. I had positive experience with every dealership I ever went in, taking my car to be serviced, whatever. I had experience with the car. But but it was just this intuition that said, this is not gonna be good. And I was right, because I ended up not buying my car from there. I went to another dealer. Because the way, just something about walking into that place, and I'll tell you what probably where the problem was. Like all the other dealers, I went pre-owned. I never buy a new car, so I went pre-owned car. And so at all of the other dealers, when you walked into their showroom, and there was no separation of the pre-owned cars versus the brand new first-time buyer. Cars, right? So this level of service was immediately the same, right? There was no distinction between, okay, this customer wants to buy a pre-owned and this customer is buying a brand new car. But when I walked into the particular dealer that I didn't feel right about, first I walked into the main dealership because that's what I thought that, that was my experience in the past. And then they're like, oh no, you need to go down and around, right? I'm like, really? So I was like, okay. So I went down and around. And when I went down and around, I felt like I was going to, like, the second class. Like, and I'm like, my experience was, wait a minute. I'm paying a lot of money for this car, and I should have. Like, so it was, but then, and I don't know if that was informed by, if my intuition that this wasn't going to be good was, that was part of it. And so I don't know if then it became a self-fulfilling prophecy because my whole lens changed by doing that, right? Because I didn't like the way the sales guy looked. He kind of reminded me. Anybody ever seen Saturday Night Fever? Is that the name of John Travolta? Night Fever. Remember how they were dressed? This is straight out of New York City, right? That's how they were dressed. Saturday Night Fever came out when I was a teenager, I think, right? That's a long time ago. This is how they were dressed. They reminded me of, and actually, really, my husband said, they look like they're straight out of The Sopranos. That whole kind of attitude. And so, I don't know if it was because, but that's the thing that we face with auditing, right? Because your priors, right, or the lens on which you look at something could become a self-fulfilling prophecy. You anchor, right? I anchored on my treatment of, when I walked in and then I had to go around. And so when I got there and it didn't look the way I needed it to look, I anchored on that, and everything following that experience was magnified as a result. And it meant that, it's no big deal. I just did buy a car from them, but for them, it was a consequence because they didn't sell a car to somebody who knew they wanted a particular car. I came there because I saw a car that they had on ride that I wanted. When they couldn't find the car at first, that was a red flag as well. But those are kinds of some of the things that we have to consider as auditors, that sometimes you anchor on information based on your priors or based on what the client told you. So when you're presented with new information, you never adjust away from that anchor. Right? You continue, and that could be a dysfunctional judgment. Maybe I would have gotten that car is a better deal than the car that I actually ended up buying. I don't think so.
It's important to note, as an auditor, one, that, again, you're susceptible to these unconscious bias, right? You're humans.
Right.
And then two, that you don't necessarily, even though you typically want to think very analytically and rationally, but you can't take intuition or emotion out of it, because when Helen was talking about inherent risk and how difficult it is to get to assess inherent risk because of the complexities of it and how you have to assess it. I've been in some audits, even internal audits, where when I went into the first meeting with management, I got a vibe about them, right? And that particular vibe about them shifted my frame, my lens on how I looked at everything else, but I became more skeptical, right? And rightly so, right?
Wow.
dispositionally skeptical though, so I probably would have been. But that specific situation, I was more skeptical, and it turns out I needed to be, right? Because there were frauds in employee purchase cards and paying terminated employees, and he just had a philosophy about him that if you went into one of their boardroom, you would look around, you know, observing, you know, before they come in the room, and they would have posters up that would say things like, ready, fire, aim, right? And indicating that they go, you know, pull the trigger before they actually aim it, think about it, which is kind of an anti-audit type of environment, but that gives you an indication of what their books will probably look like.
So actually, that's an interesting point, because Shanta made the point that she's dispositionally skeptical. Right. And so, you know, that is a hugely important aspect of audit. And, you know, there's this question of whether skepticism can be learned or is it something that's ingrained. And I do think there's a part of it, obviously, that's ingrained. And I think what can be learned is when you find yourself in a particular context, such as the audit context, or to be aware of signs that would suggest, as Shanta said, you know, she looked at it and around it was ready, fire, aim, right? Which doesn't, like that nuance, right? That doesn't make sense. It's usually ready, aim, fire, so that you're being more logical, you're being focused, right? There's an approach to it. But here is like, you know, throw it up against the wall kind of attitude and we'll make it work later, right?
That particular president of that particular unit, I won't give specifics, was actually, let's say they made ice cream, right? Milk is a big component of ice cream. They didn't have contracts with their suppliers, right? So it's an indication of ready, fire, aim. So they were getting charged these different rates depending on what the supplier wanted to charge. There were no contracts. Like, how can you have a business, big business, and not have that? Well, that was part of his philosophy that he disseminated to the employees, and that's what their structure looked like.
So, in Shanta's example, right, if we also know the same, she noticed, because she's dispositionally skeptical, she noticed that. So, how would that have, that changed her inherent risk assessment, you know, that factor. So she automatically said that's high risk. That made inherent risk higher for her, which means that increases the risk of material misstatement. Whereas someone who is not dispositionally skeptical might not, they might have just seen that sign and said, okay, well, that makes no sense. It's a typo. It's supposed to be ready, aim, fire. They made a typo. Like, why would they say that? Did they not notice it? But it wouldn't affect their inherent risk assessment. They would not have made the same connection. And so again, everyone saw that two people seeing that same sign. Someone who is skeptical is going to internalize that differently, that is going to impact their risk assessment differently. And it's going to have the effect of a higher risk assessment on the risk of material misstatement, which means that they're going to adjust their audit procedures to address that risk. Whereas someone who did not pick it up that way, they're going to assess perhaps, let's say, risk of material misstatement is moderate, and they're not going, their audit procedures, they're not going to gather as much evidence, right? And so as a result of that, I'm assuming you uncovered fraud.
Yes.
Right? That they might not uncover that fraud because of that. Right? And so a lot of the research around auditor judgment and decision making, especially the earlier research, is looking at, well, what are the factors that, you know, could result in auditors being making less than optimal decisions or decisions that are subject to biases, and how can the audit environment, or how can we improve auditing training, making, you know, so that they're aware of those biases. So now you see, for example, based on earlier research, audit firms have judgment frameworks. KPMG has one, I know Ernst & Young, and I'm sure Deloitte, PwC, all of the firms probably have a judgment and decision-making framework that they've used to train their employees. And some of the things that they talk about is what constitutes a good judgment. what does good judgment look like? What the importance of professional skepticism and critical thinking, making their employees aware of biases, and using real life business examples to demonstrate how people exhibit those biases and the things, the steps that they could take to be aware of the fact that they have biases. Because if you're aware of that, then you're more likely to be able to address it. You have to be aware of it. The same thing with professional skepticism. You can, if you're not skeptical, you're not gonna act on it. Right? So it's not like you can act on it. I can say, oh, I'm not that skeptical, but I'm gonna act skeptically. Right? Most times that you have to think skeptically and then act on it. So it's not that what if Shaka had said, okay, I'm skeptical about this controller because of this sign, because it's, you know, ready fire thing. Right? I'm skeptical, and then she did nothing to adjust her approach to that audit. Then she didn't act skeptically. Right? And that's a big challenge for auditors. It's not, one, you want them to think skeptically, but it's also important that they act on them, on the skeptical thinking. So take skeptical action. So with information technology, so you're all aware, you guys are all in the AIS program. So you know all of the really cool things that Rutgers is doing, our AIS students, what they've been exposed to, you know, and trying to apply these different like audit analytics to the, or you know, using big data, bringing this in the audit process. So clearly information technology is huge. The audit profession is moving beyond just Excel or even IDEA and ACL, right? To using more powerful tools. And so, and also from just a business model, audit firms have to be able to more efficiently and effectively audit their clients. Their clients are demanding it. But also for publicly held clients, the timing of when statements have to be filed is getting shorter. And so auditors are going to have to do a more efficient job, but more importantly, it has to be effective. Right? So let's think about the fact that if we use technology, can we come in earlier and audit? Right? How much confidence do we have in doing that? Using technology to be able to do that, or if we can use technology to gather a lot more evidence. So, you know, one of the things that we talk about a lot in AIS is this idea of auditing 100% of the population as opposed to statistical sampling. It gives you, now you're looking at a lot more items, so that technically should give you greater assurance. Because you're looking at more transactions. It should reduce your risk because you're looking at a greater population of transactions. So when we talk about IT complexity, how do you think that? So given that, if you think about audit analytics or information technology, how do you think that impacts individual decision makers? The complexity, IT complexity. When you think about an audit, financial statement auditor, not an IT auditor.
Well, they could become overwhelmed with things that they may not understand.
Exactly. What else? Overwhelmed. And what happens when they're overwhelmed?
They lose their ability to clearly, logically make a decision.
Right. And then you add to that the time pressures that they're under anyway, right, to complete an audit. What are some of the other things? Think about from your own experience when you have to learn a new computer program or a new something new with technology.
Get a new phone. Whenever I get a new phone, I always feel like it's a new learning curve instead of just expanding on a new one, right? So I always wonder with auditing in this particular era versus when I audited, like how would I have been able to adapt to that? Like what are some of the challenges you might have? Auditor trying to navigate new technologies. It's interesting. I think with that question, there's both sides, right? Jamie mentioned that it's possible that it can make you more effective, right? You're able to audit 100% versus a statistical sample and possibly make audit quality go up in that sense.
So some of the things, and we talk about this, the special issue, Accounting Horizon issue deals with a number of these, and in particular, the paper I have with Hussein and Danielle about behavioral implications of big data. And so, again, and Jamie brought this up, is that you could be, auditors could be overwhelmed by it, right? Because it's new. I just think about introducing IDEA, and Ben, how many hours did you spend? An IDEA project for my auditing class, and it took a lot of time. Right? It took a lot of time, not only just them to, for one thing, to just upload the program, right? To just upload the program, to then figure out how to navigate, even though there's this huge, really good manual of how to with IDEA. So something, IDEA, which is very much user-friendly. Would you agree, Ben? User-friendly, it's menu-driven. So it's not a complicated program, but it did overwhelm. It was different from what people were accustomed to. So the technology made it more complex, with an increase in complexity. And also, it meant that you had to use a higher, mentally you were processing, information processing. You were information processing at, more information to process that was unfamiliar to you. And so we've had research that's shown that when you have those factors, that performance is diminished. The decision maker's performance is diminished by using that. Because of the fact that your mental workload increases when you're using technology. And so we know that we have the tools to capture, process data, right? More and more data. I mean, the power of computing is far greater than it's ever been. Right? But from an audit perspective, or at least as James audit, analyzing can be problematic. So now you have all this data. What do I do with it? I can, we have programs that will allow visualization. So then what? Right? Then what? Now I can visualize. This is, how does that help? Those are still questions we need to understand from auditors, right? Like, how does that impact the auditor's judgment process? Does it help them improve their process of judgment? Do they make better judgments as a result of that, better decisions? How does it impact the evidence? One thing about big data is it's unstructured. So what's the right data? How do I filter out what I should be looking at, what's relevant versus irrelevant? And I'll talk a little bit about this bias, the dilution effect with relevant and irrelevant data. Right. And how we auditor, how it impacts their decision process. And there's also this idea of information overload. Now you have so much information. And how do when you have that much information, it negatively impacts your ability to process that information, which then is really problematic for complex judgment. So while we have this idea that the more information we get in, we should be able to hopefully reduce our uncertainty, right? Reduce the information asymmetry that exists between us and the client. But it could have negative effects because of information overload. And so another question to ask is, with the use of information technology, are we seeing biases, right, and attenuated? Right, are we seeing it? So if we do this, so we've had research that's looked at certain judgment biases in the audit context, and they found that there's certain situations or factors that can reduce a judgment bias. So for example, when auditors are accountability, so when they're accountable to a partner or a manager, they engage in more effective processing of information. In other words, they pay more attention. Right? So as a result, it impacts their judgment. It improves, their judgment improves because of accountability. Is that, we don't, in this information technology environment, especially with decision tools that are available now, that weren't available when those initial studies were done, will those tools work? Will those factors, will accountability impact auditors the same way? Right? Because now you have these other things at play, such as the, you know, unstructured information or volume of information. Right? Is that really, you know, so those are some areas that, you know, as we move into an environment where there's greater computing power and greater amounts of information, and as audit firms are trying to take advantage of all of this information that's readily available to them and incorporate that into their audit approach, we still don't know how it impacts auditor judgment. There's this idea that it should improve auditor judgment, but that's still empirical. You know, that's still an empirical question. We don't know that too, in all cases. So I talked about information overload, so I won't, but basically it results in people make, and this has been done in the general literature. So, but there's no reason for us to believe that, and I think there's been a couple of studies of information overload with auditors, but I can't remember. But there's no reason to believe that auditors are going to behave any differently, right? There's no reason. There is a cognitive process. So some of the key things, it results in inaccurate decisions, a disregard for large amounts of information. So you could be throwing out, you know, the baby with the bathwater, right? You could just be throwing out good information because you're not able to filter through what is relevant versus irrelevant. People take longer time. So think about, I don't know, how many of you have taken open book exams? Do you think you spend more time on an exam when you have an open book exam than you would normally?
Sometimes.
My experience, my students, it could just be my experience, but if, and I rarely give open book exams, but when I give an open book exam, it takes my students longer to complete the exam because they have more information available. They have the entire textbook available to them.
You're saying you probably make it harder
to. Me personally, and I don't know if this would apply in this situation, but it might. When I have an open book exam, the reason why I find it takes me more time isn't because I have all the information. Well, it sort of is, but it's mostly because I become paranoid that I make sure I got the right answer, so I have to double check everything in the textbook.
Right.
So. I guess that adds up into longer, but it's not because I have all this textbook information that I have to sift through and make sure that, like, oh, I get the right information from the textbook. It's more like I think I have the right information and I'm trying to validate the right information.
Right, and so if you take that to an audit context, right, auditors would probably do the same thing. I don't know, because we haven't...
Is it the case that it's the situation where they're, like, looking to validate it based
right,
on
they're
the
looking
data,
for confirming evidence.
Now they also have to audit the big data.
Right.
That might be an accountability expectation, right? Because
right.
because you are given an open book exam, you may feel like there's an expectation that you need to get it right because you got all the information in front of you. So that's why you go back to validate and make sure you get the same thing.
But and it could also be for a confirmation bias too, right? Like you're looking for information to confirm what
yeah.
you've already done, right? That so, which could be dysfunctional in a way, right? Because what you're doing, and you know, you have the answer. Now you're trying to find information to confirm that answer. What if your answer was wrong? You're spending all this time looking for information to confirm a wrong answer. Because you're not going to think outside. You know, you don't, it's like when you have an open book exam, for example, you're not saying, it's it's sort of like, okay, I have uncertainty, but I could go through all of this to try to reduce my uncertainty versus think through, well, if I don't have an open book, right, and I'm not sure about this answer, you might say, well, what else could it be? Right? You might look for, you know, a disconfirmment, right? You might look for an alternative hypothesis. So you're thinking differently. Whereas one, with the book, you're going to go and try to find it to support what you already believe, your priors. Whereas if you don't have that book, you can't go through it, right? So you have to think outside of the box. So you have to think about alternative hypotheses. So, I mean, you know, and so you're right, that could result, and that's an interesting, that's really interesting, Jamie, right? Because we don't know Lithia Thomas because you have, we know you have more information. It's how you use that information, or how you process that information, I should say, right? And that's, I think that's like interesting, like how would auditors process information when they have more information to them? Would they do what you said you would do when you take an open book exam, is that you try to confirm that the answer that you have, versus would auditors now, would they do that, or would they go to an approach of trying to look for alternative explanations for that, which we don't know, because we don't have it, and it's hard, right? It's what's harder is because how do we simulate this big data? Right, in an audit setting, that's the key where because a big part of experiments, right, is it, especially when you're using auditors, is you have a limited time, and most times you're trying to keep that experiment certainly under an hour, and if possible, 30 minutes the most. And we're talking managers and partners; you're trying to do it in 15 to 20, right, which is hard, right. So that's what makes
it realistic,
right. Right, is big data, right, is because you would want them to pull in different sources and then have the time to evaluate those sources, you know, in a real setting. So I think that's going to be, that's a challenge in terms of how to test this experimentally, you really using big data.
Do you find that there's situations, this is just a thought I had, like if I was a manager and I only had 15 minutes and I feel like, all right, well, I'm donating my time, like I don't really have to take this, there's a lack of consequence for not doing it properly in a study. Has there been a lot of issues where, like, as a result, the study doesn't match the practice, or is that usually, there's a way to like solve that problem?
No, because sometimes what we see is when we run it based on observe. So we want to try to explain things that have been observed. So a part of it for me is I have audit experience, right? So I know, I've been on countless audits. So I can, you know, I have some inside knowledge of how things are done on an audit. It's been my experience. So we have things in, right? If I have somebody who, if someone's gonna do, say, oh, look, I'm just doing this because, you know, the firm wants me to help out this student, then they're not going to really pay a lot of attention to it, right? They're just going to get through it. We do manipulation checks. We do distractor distractor questions. So you try to capture that the people have really spent the time on doing. Like everything I do, unless I'm doing a paper experiment, which unfortunately you can't, unless you're there physically observing, it's harder to determine how long it's taking them. But when I do online things, I always time is always one of the metrics that I capture, so I can get a feel for. Because then I want to examine the results for people who are extreme outliers. But I can tell you, so for example, one of my in my dissertation, I actually a part of it, I did a verbal protocol. I think I did two partners, two managers, as they were going through it. And they were going through it. I mean, they were having conversations with the computer because I did it online. They were interacting with a simulated client online. And they were talking like, okay, you know, I really had to say to them, could you speak up? It's like I wasn't there anymore. And, you know, it's like, okay, so you want to do that? Well, if you do that, then I'm going to do this. Like that was some of the responses that I got back. So I really do think that people, because you try to make the context a realistic context. So there, I think there, their just natural instinct in terms of, okay, I'm you know, evaluating case facts and I have to make a judgment. I think it's just, it's natural to them. I mean, and there's some things you obviously write. Like if I'm doing a negotiation, unless I have the physical there interacting with that person, I have to, that's a limitation of the study, right? I'm not able to really capture or capture something where they have a relationship with that particular client. There are nuances that I'm not gonna, so it's not generalizable to, you know, my questions are somewhat broad. Terms of how, you know, but my manipulated variables are more, were less about their conversations or their moods or anything like that. I was more interested in how certain factors that I manipulated would impact their judgment process, because they have to be aware of that, like the audit committees. Yeah, but that's a, you know, that's one of the limitations of the experiments, right, is that you don't have the actual, you know, how people behave might be different, but you try to develop your experimental tool so that it's extracting as much of the realism as you can, so that when they're in that situation, they're making a judgment the way they would make that judgment. So one of the things, so for another example would be, one way that you've seen experiments deal with, certain experiments lend themselves to be able to do that, like accountability studies. So one of the things that when people are trying to induce accountability, what they'll do is, let's say it's staff auditors or seniors, they'll say in the experimental instrument, and they might use a real a partner, you know, like this, you know, your responses to these questions will be reviewed by the partner, you know. So that automatically induces accountability. Because even though it's not, so if you're doing that in a training session, or you tell them that your responses will be, you know, evaluated after the training session and your scores will be given back, something to that effect, right? So you automatically induce accountability. So that you can, certain things you can kind of extract from the real world and build it into your experiment so that they get the same, you get the same, hopefully the same approach.
I think that's what's nice about building experiments is that you can create the environment. Like you said, if you're doing accountability measure, you can tell them, hey, this is the situation you're in, right? And you can just simply build it like that versus different methods like archival and analytical.
And it's also another thing that's really important is the relationships you establish in, with the firms, right? Because most times when, you know, like say for example, and Santa probably had the same thing, when I was in my PhD program, you know, I reached out to people, like I worked through people, as opposed to just doing a cold call and say, sending out my request, I went through, say, for the partner in charge of a particular office, or the firm's, or the campus recruited that person. And so the way they'll preface, like, oh, you know, we're working with the University of Wisconsin, this is one of their PhD students, you know, University of Wisconsin is a real big, you know, group for, so, or they'll go out to alumni, you know. So it creates this, like, okay, there's a connection.
Like a desire to help.
Right, they want to help. So they want to, you know, take the time and do it because they're helping. So you really, whereas, and this was out of, I mean, I 98% of my research is experimental. And I had only, in all that time, I've had one bad experience where I didn't have necessarily a connection with this particular firm. And this was one of the big four firms. And I didn't have a connection, and we had to really beg them, you know, sell them on getting access. And they've given us a grant to do this study. And we're like, but it's an experiment, we need access. Your firm won't be the only firm, but at least you could give us some people, right? And it was like pulling teeth. Even after they agreed to do it, it was like pulling teeth. So finally they gave us subjects, I wanna say, probably about a year and a half, 2 years after we requested it, right? And fortunately, we had gone out and gotten experiment, you know, participants from other people, other firms that we had a good, you know, a good relationship with. And so when they finally got us the subjects, right, we get it back. The answer, so it was paper-based. We got it back. One of the PhD students, Tiffany, I think, helped me. And she uploaded the responses for me in my statistical package. And she sent it to me. And so I started doing the analysis because I'm excited because I had 40 more people, right? And with experiments, the more you get, that you're just like elated. And they were supposed to be, you know, it's people experiencing fair value and so forth. So I had 40 more people. And so as I'm analyzing the results, so I kind of kept it at first separate from my earlier, because I had a variable and to distinguish. And I'm like, something's not right. Intuition, just based on my knowledge and experience, something didn't feel right about the results. And I was getting powerful results. I mean, they were just like 0.000, you know. Wow, you know, but and it's not that it was 0.000, but something as I was looking, because one of the things that I always do, because with experiments, right, that's the one thing, you're never going to really do you have like 200, unless you're doing something like going on MTurk, you know, where you're getting, but for auditors, it's usually hard, I mean, it, you know, so the one thing you can do is manageable, like I can scan it. And I do that. That's my audit training, right? I always scan data. And so I scanned it, and I'm looking, and I did some descriptive analysis. I did descriptives by, you know, by firm. I just did, and the numbers for this firm just didn't seem to have the same, a pattern similar to the other firms. And there's rarely any instance where the big four firms are so different. In terms of how they approach things. And so, long story short, once I reviewed it and I looked at it, and then I started, so I said to, I called Tiffany, and I said, Tiffany, could you bring in, bring the surveys to my office I want to take a look at them. And she brought them over, and she told me once she saw me, she says, "Oh, Professor, I just wanted to point out that when I was uploading this information, there were some answers that were identical. They were identical." She said, "There were an awful lot of them that were identical." So I said, "I knew it. I knew something was wrong with this data." And so when I went through it, sure enough, apparently what this firm had done was we had four conditions. And for each condition, it's like, I don't know that they did this, because I have no proof, but it's probably reasonable, that they filled it out, had one person fill it out, one for each condition. And then so they gave us 12 exactly in each condition. So they gave us 12 for each, so they gave us 48 in total. And so, condition A, all of the answers were the exact same. Condition B, all of the answers. And that's just not, the risk assessment was exactly the same. So I might expect that some people might have said 6, and some people might have said 5 and 7, but not everyone in that condition is going to say 7. Not everyone in condition B is going to select, 4. Right, so that was the thing, and I noticed that pattern when I was looking at it. So those are the kinds of things, those are the challenges. And that's the only time that's ever happened to me in all of the experiments that I've done. That's the only time. And the firm had to know. The person who, shouldn't say the firm, but the person who we worked with had to know that that's what they did. So, and I would rather them have just said, no, we can't give you access. Than to do something, because that's unethical.
Because what if you publish?
Right, and for me, I always scan my data. I mean, and now I do it even more, right? But I always look, I run visualization of my data to see if something doesn't. And I just scan it, because I can't, other than my experiments where I was using MTurk or something like that, I rarely had more than 100 participants, except one with the CFO data. We had close to 200. But so I, you know, I'm able to scan my data, look, you know, lined up and my condition and stuff like that. So, but anyway, that's a digress. To kind of get to your point, because Jamie had a question about whether or not, you know, results are different than what people would actually do in the real world. All right, so another consequence of big data is information relevance, right? And people, and there's been research, and this has shown that, and I'll go through a overview of an experiment with Danielle on this, but that less experienced auditors are unable, they incorporate irrelevant information into their judgments, even though they know it's irrelevant. So it's not that they're not aware of the data being irrelevant or the information being irrelevant, they still, they don't have the ability to disregard this. And this is a case where experience is a real driver of it, because you don't see this with more experienced people. So somewhere along the line, in terms of when they're gathering experience, they figure out how to distinguish, how not to incorporate or how to disregard the relevant information. And so what happened, so some a lot of the studies in an audit that's been in this area, a few anyway, it's looked at fraud risk assessments. And so fraud risk assessments are really a complex assessments, right? But you know, all SAS 99 requires auditors to assess the risk of fraud. Not audit for fraud, but assess where risk might occur. And it's supposed to include the entire engagement team, right? So so less experienced auditors are not able to discount that. So what happened is that in this, a couple of the experiments, the fraud risk was really low. And it should have been assessed as low, but because the less experienced people incorporated the irrelevant information into their decision, they assessed fraud risk higher. And so that has the effect of impacting, it could impact on the quality in the sense that you're taking away resources that you could be spending on more, on higher risk areas, and it also impacts efficiency. Makes the audit less efficient. And this one is really key, I think, for with audit analytics, right? Audit data analytics. Is there's been a lot of research that shows that auditors are not, and I'm referring to auditors, I'm not, it's probably the same situation for most individuals, but that they're not good at recognizing patterns, right? And they're developing a hypothesis based on those patterns. And so if you think about, and this work's been done in analytical procedures, right? So this is even before we have all this additional information that we could gather from big data. That auditors are just not good. So the impact of the data could just really magnify this issue. And that's why I think it's important to have, you know, when we talk about the audit data analytic tools, here's an area where those tools might really serve auditors well in helping them to be able to really identify patterns of data. Things like visualization, for example, my visualization tools might help also improve the auditor's ability in this area. And then finally, ambiguity, which is not going to go away, right? Because we talked about this earlier when we talked about just how GAAP is becoming more fair value oriented. And there's a great deal of uncertainty. And so with audit, I mean, so this is not something new to auditing. And now you have to ask yourself, in this world of big data, is it going to increase? Because now you have information, more information sources. That information is not always at, you know, as clear. Given the fact that auditors have difficulty with pattern recognition, less experienced auditors, not able to disregard the relevant information, this, all of these things might increase the ambiguity that auditors face. So because of that, they might not be, if you're, and there's an instrument that can measure your tolerance for ambiguity. And so people who are not as comfortable with ambiguity might be really uncomfortable with unstructured data, because they're not able to really be able to synthesize that data in a meaningful pattern in terms of how they'd be able to use that information. So they could disregard it, or they might assess it incorrectly. Overall, it could decrease their audit judgment. They might ignore, you know, very important information cues. So these are all some of the things that we have to think about, right, when we're thinking about how we use big data in an audit environment, because that's where firms are moving, right? I mean, that's where they'd like to be. And then what kinds of analytical tools we might be able to use that could aid auditors, help auditors, as they're thinking about, you know, as they start, you know, as they start auditing in this environment of big data. So let me be quiet for a moment, and let's talk a little bit about, given your exposure to what you've seen here at Rutgers in our car lab, some of the tools. What do you think, what are some of the tools you think can aid auditors and help them become better at JDM? What kind of tasks would be amenable to those things? So what are some of the things that you've seen some of our students doing here?
One of the things that Helen mentioned before about pattern recognition and how increased amount of data that may be difficult for auditors, right, to be able to recognize patterns. Well, one of the easiest things to do in that situation is to have it visually, right? So there are some visual aids that would obviously help auditors in terms of being able to look at large, recognize patterns in large amounts of data. And so there's tools available even on the market that will allow auditors to take advantage of different visualizations to help them illustrate where patterns may be that they wouldn't have recognized had they not looked at the entire sample of population size.
And do we know that?
Right.
Because that, I mean, to me, this is an area that I think is wide open for research and how auditors use these tools, and do these tools really have the desired effects that we believe they would have? Right? Because, you know, decision aids in past research on decision aids has shown that they don't always improve auditor judgment.
Right.
And then the other thing we'd ask, well, what audit tasks are they most relevant for, or where they're most likely to improve auditor judgment? Those are the kinds of things that I think are really interesting, that if we go with this, you know, the starter that, look, that's where the audit profession is moving, that there has to be a way for auditors to incorporate these analytic tools in the audit process, then we need to, the next thing is, well, do they improve auditor judgment? And how can we design these tools, or what factors are necessary, what types of tools are necessary to improve auditor judgment? So you guys already took, Hussein already presented, right? So he presented his exceptional exception. So that's a perfect example of where an audit analytics can improve the audit process in the sense that you can look at more information, right? So because the idea of the audit risk model is that you adjust your audit procedures, or the nature, timing, and extent of your audit procedures, and in terms of the extent, how much evidence do I need to collect to drive this risk down or keep this risk low, audit risk low? And so if you go with these, if my extent already starts at I'm looking at 100%, that's great. But unless I look at 100% and there are no outliers, then I still have some judgment there, right? There's still some judgment, And because there's some judgment, I'm still subject, there's still the risk of these biases, decision-making biases that auditors face. So what kind of tools do we need to design around, that, hey, yeah, that's a great audit analytic, right? I have to look at 100% of the population. But then what other tools do I need to help auditors still make better decisions? Because the decision to run the analytic is not a high, it's not a complex decision. That's not where the complexity comes in, right? But you run the analytic. Now it's like evaluate the outcome, right? Evaluate the output of the analytic. And that's where more judgment, that's where we need to examine how auditors, you know, whether or not the decision process is improved, or what barriers exist. Are they over-reliant on those tools? Do they under-rely? Because certainly you don't want them to disregard.
That's an important question, even something that I'm working on right now, because we can assume that, you know, there could be certain efficiencies in doing some looking, using an audit analytic to look at a population, etc. But does that change the judgments that an auditor would make, right? Versus doing it in a traditional way or a manual way or something like that. And one of the things, I know you moved on, but one of the barriers that I think auditors will have to face, it's interesting because when I talk to different people from different firms about their use of analytics, one thing comes up that I guess is an academic I never even thought of, is that they're talking about the fact that they have to test the tool as well, especially for completeness when it comes to the PCOB, because they want to know, okay, maybe the auditors are relying on this tool and they could be using it as a checklist, right? What things are you doing to ensure that that's not happening, or that you've gotten all the information that you needed to get into that tool, that you're looking at the complete population? And then they're wondering about, as the industry moves forward and they're embracing analytics and these different tools and things like that, how does that actually change the nature of an audit, right? Are these tools in addition to what an auditor normally does, or techniques in addition to what an auditor normally does? Does it reduce it? Are they only used as risk assessment processing during that process? Like, how does this change the nature of what we think of as audit, right? So it's a lot of barriers that may not be as obvious in the beginning, but in terms of whether or not it's benefiting the profession, I think that it doesn't change the way that audits were done in the past and how good they were. It's an evolution, right? As we're exposed to more technology, more techniques to audit, we can increase the quality, we can make it better. But we have to face these different judgment biases that might creep in that we never considered.
So this I stole from Nick Brooks. I hope you don't mind. This nice slide, a couple less.
You didn't steal from me, this is from the IAESB task force.
Well, I took it from your slides. So.
And I stole it from them.
Yeah. Well, we're consistent, and I'll plagiarize techniques that much. But I thought I liked this example that Glenn Nichols presented it, because, and this gets a little bit to what Shantra was talking about. I think from a research perspective, right? There's so much ground to cover, right, with audit data analytics, because, you know, I think that's one of the, as Shantra pointed out, that's always a question that comes up. Well, where do we use audit data analytics? Well, is this like, you can use audit data analytics across the different phases of the audit. It's very much, to me, an evolution, because the objective of an audit has not changed. It's how we conduct that audit. Like, how do we, what are the procedures that we perform to meet the objectives, right, to satisfy the objectives? The assertions are not going to change. Management assertions do not change. So we still, as auditors, they still have to give evidence in support of the assertions that management's making. So the objective hasn't changed. It's the tools that we use to gather that evidence. That's what's changing. And I consider that an evolution. There's still going to be a risk assessment process. There's still going to be internal evaluation with publicly held companies, and you're going to, you know, maybe what changes is now substantive analytical procedures moves up to being more reliable, Because right now, under the traditional approach, substantive analytical procedures are probably the least effective audit test, right? So what you find is you'll never, ever just use substantive audit, analytic procedures to test revenue recognition. You will never get away with doing that in a traditional audit, right? Because they're, so substantive analytical procedures is really almost confirming, I would think, or providing additional evidence to support confirmations, for example, or to support your internal control evaluations. So but maybe now, with more advanced data analytics, maybe substantive analytical procedures can become a more effective test, a more effective way to gather evidence. And that, to me, those are empirical questions. We don't know that because we haven't had the opportunity to really examine that in an audit context. But you're still, all the phases of the audit is going to be the same. That's not going to change. It's how we implement the tools we use to gather evidence that changes. So so we all, you know, here at Rutgers, we talk a lot about audit analytics, but we have, I mean, there are a host of different technologies, and most of you have seen those just sitting through some of the presentations that some of the PhD students are working on. But, you know, again, some of the things that we talked about as being challenges for auditors, audit analytics can help with identifying, analyzing patterns and outliers and transaction data. Hussein presented his exceptional exceptions, right? So you can identify that. And what does that do from an audit perspective, right? So right now we use statistical sampling. And, you know, we have statistical sampling techniques. We select a sample of transactions. We evaluate those transactions. If we're evaluating them for internal controls, if they meet the internal controls criteria. And if there are sections we have, remember early on when I talked about the judgment, one broad area, do I extend my audit procedures or not? Right? Auditors have to make that decision if they find exceptions that fall outside of their tolerable rate of exceptions. Well, who's to say that they can't? Here's the challenge, but you will develop a tolerable rate of exceptions using audit analytics over time, right? You're gonna know what's tolerable. And the problem that auditors have is the standards don't really address it, right? But you can still, now, but the difference though is with statistical sampling, you have to extrapolate those back to the population and say, okay, if I had 3% error rate, now I have to extrapolate that back to the entire population and say that I probably have a 3% population, you know, error rate in my population. Well, with audit analytics, you know what your errors are. Right? Now, you have to determine whether they're real errors, or, but you know that for 95% of the population, those transactions were good. And I have this 5% here that are potential, what do you call it, notable items? Is that the new term? Notable items. But I know that I'm only dealing with notable items, right? 5%. Those are my notable items. And I have, now that could translate to 5,000 transactions, I don't know, which is still a lot. We have to figure out a way to test those. What are Hussein's, and what Wong is working on, you know, those are ways to try to manage that number. But you know you're working with notable exceptions, right? And you know that 95% is correct.
Yeah, we're conducting risk-based audits. It served a reason that focusing more on those notable exceptions would be where the risk is, the majority of the risk is.
Right, so to me, what you're reducing your information asymmetry that you cannot reduce in the same way using statistical sampling. And I think the challenge, and how auditors internalize that and process that, because it probably is when you see 5,000 notable exceptions that we talked about being overwhelmed, right? And how that information overload, and that could have a negative impact on your decision process and how you determine what you're going to look at, right? I think now firms, if they're doing that, they say they use statistical sampling, right? And that goes to look at the exceptions, which again is you know, that's the best tool that they have right now, but that they have at least at their discretion. But we, you know, we know here, the, you know, at Rutgers, that they're just based on what Hussein is doing, Juan knows, doing, that they're trying to develop a much better risk-based approach to analyzing those exceptions. And so how do auditors use that? So we, all of these things that we believe audit analytics can do, as I said before, I think provides a great opportunity for research. On auditor judgment and decision-making. So Miklos always gave this. I think this is a great illustration, right? So you have, so.
It's actually KPMG's.
Okay, KPMG.
Phil McCullough.
Oh, Phil, right. Jesus. So the revenue three-way match, right? So remember, when I started out talking about testing controls. And so with audit analytics, to have a tool that looking at 100% of transactions around the revenue three-way match. So for every invoice, there should be a shipping document and sales orders received from the customers, which are then compared to the invoice, customer quantity, unit price, the quantity shipped from the shipping document, and the quantity and the unit price reflected in the sales order received from the customer. So that's probably easy to do, an easy program to write. And running that. So there are other challenges, as Sean brought up, that do completeness, but the auditors can develop, testing for that. So you're able to obtain the evidence about the existence and the accuracy of revenue by doing that, which are key management asserts that the revenue exists, that it actually occurred. Right? And so if you're talking about shipping, one measure of that revenue occurring is if the items actually shipped on or before 12/31. So there's no cutoff issue. Right? And that the amounts then reflected in the financial statements of the sales journal are indeed what we shipped to the customer. So prior to that, you would test the internal controls over the revenue process, you perform some substantive analytical procedures, and you test a detailed sample. Right? And so you would do a sample, select it, and verify those things. Well, with audit analytics, you could look at 100% of those transactions that's reported for revenue, right? And then you now have the ability to look at, well, what are my outliers or my notable exceptions, right? So in this example, we have ABC, his revenue is about $125 million, generated 725,000 transactions, which are a lot of transactions. And this is the result by executing a three-way match, right? So you see that you have, roughly 4.7%, right? Less than 5% are outliers or notable differences. The auditors could then provide what is it based on this quantity difference versus pricing differences. So this, but it's still a large number of transactions. And so that's the challenge. There's a large number of transactions. And how do we then determine what are the transactions that we want to look at further? But and so the point here is that there's still judgment involved. So nothing about, I think, audit analytics, especially in these situations, will take away auditor judgment. And that to me is what's key. We want to see how the use of these procedures or the use of these tools impacts auditor judgment. Where can we improve auditor judgment? Will it result in an auditor demonstrating biases that we've seen in the past, or will the use of these tools help to mitigate some of the biases? And to me, again, as I said, I think those are questions that, we have to consider as we move along with audit analytics. Some of the questions that have come up with respect, or the challenges that arise with respect to audit analytics is the three-way match procedure data analytics, or is it automation? I don't know, what do you think? What would you say? Is it just automation, or is it audit analytics? Ben?
I think first 1 or 2 years became audit analytics, but after two or three years, it became well mentioned and part of the ERP system.
So, but this is the auditor, right? So this is the external auditor performing this. Use obviously using the client's data, right?
Yeah, for the external auditors, the data analytics.
Is it the output that's really where we start to perform the audit analytics, right? So is it that we're using automation, advanced automation to generate results or gather evidence, and then it's the output from that evidence that we now apply more data analytic tools? This is really, I don't know, and this is interesting because this came up before, before I seen, I saw this slide, right, I have a study, which actually I'm going to present, it's an experiment that I'm going to present on the 31st. Did you say the 31st? Am I presenting on March 31st?
We have a department meeting.
No.
Two department meetings in New Brunswick.
I have to check with one. I'm presenting.
Research day?
No, not at the AIF. But I'll check with one. I know I'm presenting. But I have a research paper with where we conducted an experiment using MTurk. And so what we were trying to determine is, because we attended a KPMG faculty consortium. And they were talking about all the wonderful things that they're doing with audit analytics. And so I'm sitting there with the two co-authors that I'm working with, and you know, we said, almost instantaneously, we said, I wonder how that's gonna, you know, how that impacts the expectations gap. Like, will users of the financial statements assume higher assurance? Because all the firms will say that this doesn't change the level of assurance. Just because we could look at 100% of the transaction, we're still only providing reasonable assurance. But we said, will users, if they're aware of the fact that auditors are able to audit using these tools, would that change their expectations or how they would hold the auditor responsible in the case of a subsequent audit failure? And so, long story short, I don't even think, but we looked at, and one of the things, so we looked at the use of audit analytics, and we used this, an example where they were able to examine, technology to examine 100% of the transactions. And when my co-authors presented this paper at their respective institutions, and the question came up, someone said, but is this really analytics? Or a couple of times it came up, or is it just that it's advanced audit, you know, it's automation? And so we were like, okay, we didn't really think about that, right? But it did change. Everyone was like, okay, yeah, but it still doesn't change the central theme of the question that we're asking. It's just, so we had to think about how we described it in the paper. But this question did come up. They were like, well, is that really audit analytics, or is it this? You're just using automation. But does it matter?
Right? Like, we're going to always have that particular debate,
right?
Because we work.
But for our question, right.
Like, still, nobody has a pure consensus on
right.
Even what we mean by quote unquote big data. So, we're just going to have this
conversation. Right.
I think it denotes a weakness in the traditional model, because the traditional model doesn't give credit to the full population testing that we do in this case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When you come up with your prior example of 95% that didn't fail the test, you have evidence that you never had before.
Right.
You examine for two factors, and what I always say with that slide is that with knowledge of the systems or of the data, you increase the number of filters. Might be only price and quantity, but there'll be other kind of things that you put in there, and because you can do it at very little cost, just add it. And the audit procedures, I said this to the PCMB, the audit procedures don't give credit. And actually this is what Mike Lennonson from EY would say, is when we do this, we know much more than we knew before.
Right, exactly. And also, if you consider statistical sampling, there's a lot of judgment in that goes into developing the factors, right? The inputs to do, right? Because you never, in that case before, right, there were 725,000 transactions. Well, it doesn't, after a certain point, you're only going to look at a certain number of under statistical sampling using the statistical sampling tables. You're only going to look at a very small amount of those transactions, right? And also, the inputs that you use, like your tolerable, you know, misstatement risk, the expected deviation, all of those are judgments based on prior experience. And so if you got those judgments wrong, or if something changed that would suggest that your priors are no longer valid or need to be adjusted, if you don't pick that up, if you don't do that, that's gonna impact your testing.
What's the difference between the procedure data analytics and automations? Between the whether the judgment is in environment or not.
So in this case, right, your judgment is, because the tool is the tool. So you know, and to me the in your running, so let's say when you're developing the criteria for the tool, those criteria are based on the client's or what you consider to be an effective control. So those control, in that case, the control was shipping document, customer invoice, you know, price list to be compared to the quantity and so things. Those are very objective measures, right? So you design the tool based on those very objective measures. It's the output, right, that when you have and of course, you have to make sure that the data is complete and so forth. But those, to me, are the same steps you perform statistical sampling. You need to know that you're sampling from the entire population and the appropriate population for that test, right? So that, to me, doesn't change. It's the same here. To me, the analytic part, and I don't know that it matters, but when you're going to really, your judgment comes in on the output. But again, that's no different than with statistical sampling. Right? Because with statistical sampling, of course, audit analytics, this is a more powerful test because you're able to look at the entire population and then focus, as Sandra pointed out, on those items that are the notable exceptions. Those are considered your riskier. That's where your risk is. Right? Now the auditor has to determine, in that case, I don't remember what it was, but I have at least 5% that were exceptions, and that amounted to, let's say, 30,000 transactions out of 725,000 transactions, right? But that amount, so I have to decide, am I prepared to sign off on this and say this is effective? There's no material misstatement. But that's the same decision, or do I need to look further? Do I need to drill down even further on these 30,000 transactions? I have to do the same thing with statistical sampling. Right? Because if I have, you know, after I've selected and I examine, and what if I have 5% of my transactions that I selected for examination, I found errors or notable exceptions. I have to decide as an auditor, am I willing to live with that? Or do I extend my audit procedures? And to me, your outliers, once you make your decision, you're gonna, how you look at those outliers is just basically extending your audit procedures. Because the tool that you ran, whether you call it automation or what, that tool that you used, that was an audit test.
Is it really the same decision though? Because if you run a full population test, you can actually look at that 5% and see the total value of that 5%. And yeah, it was a decision in the first place to see what value is material or not. But if you weren't able to test the whole population, you still found that 5% of your sample failed the test.
But now you know.
But you don't know what the value of all the failed 5% is. There could be one transaction in there worth $1 billion.
Where, in the analytic or in the statistical sampling?
In the analytic, you definitely know that the $1 billion transaction failed.
Right.
In the statistical sampling,
you don't
know the value.
Right, so that's what I'm saying. the analytic is a more, this tool is more powerful, right? It's a more powerful test, and it does provide you with warning because you could drill down on that information, right? And so you could find, okay, it's 5%, but it's one transaction. So I'm gonna pull out that transaction and look at it. But you're absolutely right, with statistical sampling, you don't know, because the only thing you can do is extrapolate it back. You still don't know what, you just know that that 5% means X. You don't know anything about the transactions in that 5%. Here you do.
But you're removing a decision from the decision-making process. Before, when you use just statistical sampling, you now have to decide, are most of these transactions, they're more likely to be low-value transactions. So I don't really need to delve more into
this. I don't think you remove the decision. I think it becomes a less complex decision.
Because you still have to make the decision based on that known 5% or extrapolated
right.
5%. You can't just say, okay, it's 5%. Especially if we're talking about what it took to get up to that point, right? So in the situation where you're doing the analytic, right, the three-way match, right? I think the decision there is that enough to say now we can focus on that 5% and not test, you know, do other procedures versus the statistical sample, you have to go in and do that. And you have to decide what to do with that, the AR rating.
My confusion is that in the beginning, you make a decision, what is material, right? So say any violation greater than $100,000 is a material and it's gonna cause an issue.
Right.
When you do statistical sampling, you know that 5% failed, but you don't know if it adds up to 100,000.
Right.
So you have to go in and see if it
right.
becomes material. If you do a full population test, then you know
exactly.
the total value.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to decide, is there a chance that this 5% is material or not?
Right, but, so you're absolutely right. You don't have to decide if it's material or not. But let's just say, that's what I'm saying is, do you want to extend your test or not? So you might, an auditor might say, okay, I would think reasonably, if we could determine that it's not material, then you can say, well, I don't need to do, you can say with greater certainty, I don't need to do any additional procedures.
Well, I don't have experience as an auditor, so I don't know this, but if you did just statistical sampling and you find that 5% are like not going to work, but it's an account that usually has low transaction value. Are there auditors out there that would say it's only 5%? There's no way this could realistically be material. We don't have to test it any further.
Yeah, if it has low, that was the decision. Do I extend my testing, or do I say, okay, I'm going to say this is material, or I'm going to say it's immaterial. And here's the basis for me saying that.
Right.
That's the auditor judgment, right?
I guess it doesn't really cut out a decision so much as a
right.
step in the process.
Right. But I think the decision, there's less uncertainty when you use this, when you use audit analytics, than when you use statistical sampling. Because statistical sampling, when you have those notable exceptions, right, you have to extrapolate it back. You have to do that. So that's an extra step. You're not extrapolating anything back. And you're just saying, okay, here's what it is. With statistical sampling, I have to take that 5% and apply it to my entire population, evaluate whether or not that rises to the level of materiality, what number of transactions that could be. And I don't know anything about those transactions. So my decision is really whether is it material or not material, right? Does it fall under my materiality? But if you're testing internal controls, then that is not the case, right? Because internal controls is not about whether or not it's material or not material. It's was this internal control violated? And then you have to evaluate if this internal control is violated, does it rise to the level of material weakness, significant deficiency, and what impact does that have on the financial statements? Here, you're absolutely right. You can look at you know exactly which transactions, and you can look at them. Now, again, it's 30,000, so we're gonna have to apply some kind of technique, right? Which is what Hussein and Renaud looking at, do we apply this risk base to see what is in that 30,000, even though it's 5%. And in this case, you can tell us, you know what the quantity is. So if we say, okay, let's say all of these are bad, then is it material? But if it's a control violation and you have to, what kind of control? Where is there a pattern? And where these transactions are occurring, right? Where the control is failing, and in these transactions? Is it a particular vendor? Is it a particular offer? Right, so you could do more because now you can just focus on those out, those notable exceptions, whereas in statistical sampling, you're not allowed, you can't. It's greater uncertainty. So the decision process here, yes, there's still a decision, but it's not as complex. It's not as risky, I think, depending on the outcome.
Luckily, Google said that thought about it,
but
it's just way more informative.
Right. You have, yeah.
And then the risk-based audit, you know, it's always that give and take between effectiveness and efficiency, right? And so you telling me I can, in a risk-based audit, I can focus my resources on more risk, then I think it's going to benefit the audit quality. It's more information.
And so, you know, obviously we have technology in audit that, you know, it's not audit data analysts, it's just, you know, the opportunity to capture larger amounts of data, right? And so, you know, in the past, the research that's been done on technologies in the audit space has been around decision support systems, which are knowledge-based systems that are used to improve auditors. Assist auditors in their judgments and assist to improve the quality of the decisions, right? So, you know, in fact, Child's working on a decision support system based on verbal protocols that we did, Child Nichols, and that we did with an audit firm where we sat down with their audit partners, Nichols, sat down with their audit partners as they went through. And I presented this before, as they went through the risk assessment process, the planning risk assessment process, and we captured, recorded everything they said, and then coded it and all of this other stuff. So Child's using that information to develop this decision support system, because the idea that the firm had is, to the extent possible, can we, you know, assist auditors in their judgment? And it's really around, and we actually found this in the verbal protocol, less time was spent on control risk. Discussions about control risk assessment, and more time was spent on factors that are really play into inherent risk, which is by far, I think, of the two risk assessments, the more complex, and the one where you're more likely to get convergence if you have, in terms of what the risk assessment should be, if you have knowledge, people with the expertise and knowledge to do it. So we had partners and managers, and then, so we're, you know, in the decision support tool, it would help auditors be able to, you know, make more appropriate risk assessments, consider you know, and how, and in this case, really, and also weight, like what should that weight be? How much weight should I give to a factor that, you know, an inherent risk factor, such as fair value. If the company has a lot of fair value measurement, do I need to bring in a specialist? Do they use a specialist? Those are, how do we using, take all of these components, these factors, how do we combine these factors to come up with an effective risk assessment for that area? So decision tools are, you know, decision support tools are not new to auditing. I wanted to also and then talk about expert systems. And so again, they can be really, you know, basic, or they can be more complex. And so what expert systems are really trying to do is leverage for the novice, right? This, what experts have, just, you know, basically where they, you know, it's intuitive to them based on their expertise and their knowledge. How do you leverage that so that a novice performing that task will be able to make a decision like an expert, right? So you can see based on this site that, you know, expert systems have been used as well. But now with technology, we have the ability to, you know, develop more powerful expert tools. So I want to talk about one of the systems, because we're, I'm going to finish up here, where we, with of a study that used an Edgewood system, we'll probably talk about this before, but I'll be really brief. But this was from Danielle Lamarck, as Nicolosa student who's now in Villanova. And in her dissertation, she developed an expert system to try to address a known auditor judgment bias, which was dilution. And that is, where auditors, I talked about this before, and this is a big issue, right? That could be potentially a big issue with big data, is less experienced auditors are not really good at disregarding irrelevant information. And so because they don't disregard this information, they incorporate it into their judgments and decisions, which results in less than optimal judgments. And so Danielle developed this working with some people who had developed a similar system for the medical field. So, and that's another thing, people think about systems that are used in other fields that could be applied or adapted to the audit department, and this and that was one. Because think about, some medical decisions are made with a lot of uncertainty, and there's not a consensus all the time in what the right approach or treatment should be. So the dilution effect, as I said, with Danielle, was like, well, what if, because the dilution effect is only found in less experienced auditors or novice auditors, you can use experienced auditors to train the system, the expert system, and that is what Danielle did. She used partners and managers in the same case, and she used a case that has been well tested in the research, in the audit research, and she used the same case, and she developed the system based on the expert knowledge from these partners and managers in a public accounting firm. And so the way that it was set up was, it consisted of two parts, and it was the task was for a risk assessment. It was a rule-based mechanism, which most expert systems contain, because it allowed for, and she used SAS 99. So with SAS 99, right, because SAS 99 is the auditing standard that guides the auditor's responsibility with respect to assessment of risk on audit engagements. And so using those factors, those fraud risk factors that were outlined in SAS 99, and also because this case had been used in a couple of audit studies in the past, we had an ability to judge the accuracy of the expert system, and also knowledge discovery. So one of the things with the expert system is, it learns, right? It has the ability to learn. So you can train less experienced auditors to help them make better decisions. And also there was feedback, constructive dialogue. And in this, because one of the things that we did that was important to Danielle in designing this is she didn't want to take away, because again, remember when I talked about experiments, one of the things that you want to do, to the extent possible, you want to make it realistic, right? So one of the things you don't want to do is you don't want auditors to over-rely. So you want them to think about their judgments. So one of the things she had them do is they had to justify their final judgments. And remember, I talked about accountability in her experiment as well. She had, in the case, they were accountable, right? So she created an environment where, I can't remember exactly, but basically that the work would be reviewed. So it created this feeling of accountability, as well as having to justify their final decisions. Because that's what happens in an audit, right? An auditor has to be able to defend their position. So the way the case was set up, it was an experiment, a repeated measures experimental design. So what that means is that they made a decision at two points in time. So the first part of the experiment, there were two groups. One group received only relevant information, and the second group received both relevant and irrelevant information. Then the same case facts except for that manipulation. Both groups use the expert system. So the relevant, so in part one of the case, what they did, we She gave them the case information. They had to make an initial judgment. Both groups had to make an initial fraud risk assessment. And then then in phase two is when we introduced the expert system. And both groups had to use the expert system in developing their final fraud risk judgment and then submit their final judgment and also justify their judgment. If they deviated from the recommendation of and that's what the expert system does. It's like based on this information, this suggests the fraud risk should be within this range and so forth and so on. And you have the ability as the auditor, and that's what was really important, was to say whether you accepted you agreed with the expert system. And if you didn't, then you're still able to report what you think the fraud risk assessment should be and justify your decision, because you have to be able to support your decision. So we didn't want it to be a situation where auditors felt as though they had no ability to make a judgment, that they were just following the expert system because they hadn't documented their reasons for doing that. And so both groups had to do that. The other thing that Daniel did was for a certain segment of these individuals, she conducted a verbal protocol so that they, as they were going through the process, they actually spoke aloud and she captured that information, which she uses to explain some of the results. So that's what made a repeated measure. They made a fraud misjudgment at time one, and they made one at time two using the expert system. And so that way, each group, each participant serves as their own control. So this is kind of hard to see, but this dotted line represents the relevant and in group that has both relevant and irrelevant information. And this straight solid line represents the group that has only relevant information. And so what we found is at time one, you see the group that had relevant and irrelevant information made higher fraud risk assessments. Right? And those fraud risk assessments significantly decreased, and it should have, because in this case, they over-assessed fraud, but they assessed fraud risk is too high. And then after using the expert system, right, they assessed fraud risk more in line with the relevant only group. The relevant only group, you can see this line is really not moving. So the change between time one and time two for this group was insignificant, right? And both in this group, the relevant group at time one, made fraud risk assessments consistent with the expert panel. And so there was no significant difference between their fraud risk assessment and the more experienced expert panel. Whereas the group, the relevant and irrelevant group, they made fraud risk assessments significantly higher than the expert panel. So they over-assessed fraud risk. But after using the expert system decreased the fraud risk assessment. So now their fraud risk assessment was similar to both the expert group as well as the group that had relevant information only. So the expert system had an impact. The reason that Danielle did the verbal protocol, because she wanted to address the issue of whether, well, it's just, so both groups had the expert system. So if the expert system they just went through the expert system, so that's causing them to reduce their fraud risk, then we would have seen that both groups would have reduced their fraud risk assessment. But only the irrelevant and relevant group reduced their fraud risk assessment. And she also wanted to capture what their reasoning was, for to capture what it is that those groups were looking at. And so she saw that a lot of times the groups that had irrelevant information that they were looking at were irrelevant information. It was relevant information for business risk, like, I can't remember exactly, but something with like depreciation. So it was something for business risk, but it wasn't a fraud risk factor.
so I can't really see from here, mm-hmm. but it looks as though people that started using the expert system.
Well, everybody used the expert system.
The people that, where it decreases, it looks as though they evaluated lower when they, so the people that
right.
started using the expert system.
Right, so, you mean this group?
No, the dotted line.
They did. That's the group that had relevant and irrelevant information.
Yeah. Did they end up evaluating fraud risk lower than the experts and the people with only relevant information?
Like, is it below the regular line?
No, it's insignificant.
Oh, okay.
I was going to say it might have been like the difference between the two at time two. It was insignificant.
Yeah. Okay.
Statistically,
right.
So yeah, it might have been that one was 4 and one was 3.95 or something,
but
the difference was.
Yeah, oh, I didn't see the scale there yet.
It's hard to see on that. Right, but it was insignificant. So it was, and it was not significantly different from the expert panel, right? So the expert panel didn't use the tool, right? Because they don't need to. They don't suffer the dilution effect. And that's been proven in prior research that it's this dilution effect is only inexperienced or novice auditors are affected by the dilution effect, right? And so this is a case where, what it does is, to read the case, and so the expert system, it takes them through so that they focus on fraud risk factors based on SAS 99, right? So people can pick up SAS 99 and read it, right? But it's that it's this constructive dialogue and feedback that, okay, you know, SAS, and I can't remember the wording of it, but the expert system was to try to engage their cognitive processes around SAS 99. And so that they, so what it shows here is that an expert system is an example of something that might be able to mitigate the dilution effect or this bias where auditors incorporate irrelevant information, even though they know it's irrelevant. And we knew that they knew it was irrelevant because prior research told us that, but we also asked them, right? You know, we also asked them and they knew it, you know, they ranked what's irrelevant versus not. So they knew it, but they were still bringing it in because they viewed it. It's just that having that information there, they felt that compelled to use that information, even if it had nothing to do with fraud. They felt compelled to use that information. So we're still in the process of trying to really understand, analyze the verbal protocol analysis to, we coded everything, but to try to, use it to help explain what it is about irrelevant information. So just on a very broad level, what we know is that most of the information that they used that was irrelevant was business risk, not fraud risk. So that's just an example. So again, what other tools can we use an expert system for to help auditors, address some of the, and here's protected. How would we adapt something like this using big data? Could we use something like this in terms of the analysis of exceptional exceptions? And I think that's what Juan Doe's project with Radar is trying to do, using a risk-based approach to help auditors better identify those notable exceptions. So in this case, fraud risk should have been lower, but if they made fraud risk high, when they assess fraud risk higher, that creates inefficiency. In the audit approach. Oh, just some other things. I talked about the risk assessment decision support that Chow and Professor Passarelli are working on based on a verbal protocol analysis to see if we could develop a decision. Do you want to talk a little bit about that, Chow? Your risk the decision support?
For now, we start from the protocols we have for four cases. So we try to extract the common procedures and the topic that they discussed. And as Professor said, many of the topics we are focusing on the business factors, the external factors, so like the environmental risk. based on this information, because there are only four cases and each of them are for one industry, so we think that we need more information about different things for that industry and for different clients. So based on these protocols, we try to establish a more general framework for the disease support system. So that's a start, but we want to cover more and like propose more different various information that auditors may consider, such as the use. We plan to propose how auditors can use the different information in the news, the formats they can use, how those information can be summarized so that auditors can actually consider them as the decision support.
So that, and then the risk assessment process is really important because it is the basis for developing your approach to the audit, right? You know, once you just determine the risk of material misstatement, you're going to adjust the nature, timing, and extent of the audit procedures. So it has a significant impact. And as I said before, the audit is a risk-based audit. The approach is risk-based. Then we have another project that we're working on. It's an expert analysis tool used to evaluate it, basically exceptions. Control risk exceptions. Denise developed this tool based on a project that, using real data, that she worked on for in the car lab and developing a tool to look at the procurement car transactions that this company engaged in. And before this, they had a manual tool in Excel, and basically the internal auditor responsible for this area basically eyeballed it. And you know, went through all of these transactions and tried to find the exceptions or violations to the company's P-card process. So Denise developed an expert analysis tool where basically same thing, kind of would guide the auditor in terms of identifying different types of transactions that are usually significant indicators of a fraudulent transaction or a transaction that's outside of the company's stated use for the P-card program. And then it captures the risk assessments so the auditor still has to make a risk assessment. They evaluate the transactions, make a risk assessment, and decide on the various ways to analyze the transactions using this expert tool as a guide. So we ran it in my auditing class, and what we found was the students who used the expert analysis tool made higher risk assessments, which it should have been, the risk and higher fraud risk assessments, because in this case it was we had seeded fraud errors in it, and it was high risk than those students who just used IDEA. We still had a tool in IDEA, but it wasn't a guided tool, so it didn't have many of the guidance that the expert analysis tool had. And so now what we're hoping is that we'll get the firm that gave us funding for this, that we'll get access to their auditors so we can test this tool using auditors as opposed to auditors. So what I'm going to do, I have a class of four, so to say. I'm going to let Shanta talk to you about next week, what we're going to do next week. And I'm going to
make sure I get the rules first. guys up for next week. And one of the things you're going to work on for next week.
I'll see you guys next week. I'll see you in a little while then.
I'll be brave. Don't worry. One of the things you're going to do for next week is you're going to be in teams of two, right? And you're going to come up with your own kind of research question involving a judgment decision-making research question involving information technology, right? So you have the freedom to be able to choose amongst your team what you want that particular research area or research question to be. And it could be based off of something that was presented, maybe in questions like, be interesting to answer this. Things to keep in mind is that when you're talking about judgment and decision making research, you want to have some sort of theory based out of sight, usually, right? So maybe if someone's using a decision support system, what sort of biases might creep in? Or if someone is auditing information or client's own system, or maybe they have their own specific type of internal control structure around their ERP, what sort of problems can an auditor actually incur, right? So feel free, right? No pressure, it's okay, keep doing it, right? So I'm gonna give you some brief things that will help you actually be able to conquer this giant that I just introduced, and I'll tell you more specifics about it. So in behavioral research of PhD students, we live by something that's called the Kinney Three Paragraphs, right? And trust me, no matter what type of research you do, it's gonna be paramount to your success with the reviewers and the journal articles. So I'm gonna give you that real quick. Okay? And then I'll give this to Chow as well so you guys can have it, so don't worry about it. Okay. Two things that in behavioral research we are always told as PhD students and we live by is something called the Kinney Three Paragraphs and the Libby Box. And I think Jamie brought up something about how do you make sure that the experiment is not too different, like you don't get results that are too different from what reality is. The Libby 5 boxes, the predictive validity boxes, is actually what we use to design the experiment to make sure we have external validity. Okay. So I'm going to give you guys those two. Bill Kinney is a professor at UT Austin, right? And he came up with this article called Empirical Accounting Research Design for PhD Students. And that's where the Kinney Three Paragraphs come from. But basically, what they're saying is whenever you have an idea, big, small, before you even start writing, you should be able to answer these three questions really quickly, right? Three paragraphs. The first paragraph is going to be what? It's always defining what your research question is. Right? So whenever somebody's in the elevator and you're like standing next to McLose and he's like, what are you working on? Or whenever you're in those car lab meetings and he's like, real quick, tell me what you're doing. This is what he means. Tell us what the Kinney Three are, right? But like one of my committee members was always like the elevator speech. You should be able to tell me what you're doing in like less than a minute. So the first paragraph is always the what is your research question? The second is always, why is it important? Like, just because someone hasn't done it doesn't mean it's an important research question. Like, who should care? Why should they care? What's your contribution? And then the third one is the how. What do you plan to do about it? Are you doing some sort of model? Are you gonna do an archival study? Are you gonna do an experiment? How do you plan to do that? Kinney Three, very simple, save your life, trust me. I still do it whatever. I have any sort of research project that I want to work on still to this day, or if I want to get co-authors, and I'm like, this is what I'm working on, I send them the Kinney Three. It's like, hey, I haven't started yet, I haven't done any lit review, this is my topic, this is why I think it's interesting, like, this is the contribution we're going to sell to the journals, and I think we should do it this way, right? So ask yourself, what are you trying to find out, right? X's and Y's, of course. What does X cause Y to vary? Or usually does X cause Y to vary? Why is it important to find out? And who cares about it, right? is this an important issue? Because the PCAOB is saying that data analytics doesn't count as audit evidence, right? And we're trying to convince them that it does. Well, that's pretty important, okay? And how do you plan to do it? What's your method? The data you plan on using, the analysis, right? Simple stuff, testing. Oh, skip that part. These slides, some of them came directly from Bill Kinney himself. And so when he's presenting, he's like, hey, by the way, why don't you do this real quick? That's not for you guys. That's just, I kept his original slides intact in part. These are just some things to help you when you're developing your question, right? So facts are real-world observables. Problems are kind of relationships between the facts that you don't understand, right? So when you're thinking of your research question, kind of think, okay, I don't really understand how this works, or maybe there's a relationship between two things that people didn't realize. Maybe, you know, drinking coffee in the morning affects the auditor's ability to kind of negotiate with the client in terms of the audit adjustments. Who knows? Theories are the ideas about the causal relationships between the fact. Well, maybe there's a theory in psych about sleep deprivation and caffeine, right? And then hypotheses are the predictions of the real world observables that you should observe if your theory is descriptive of the real world. It's basic stuff. These are just kind of the things that got me through my PhD program. Just like that. Doesn't want to move. All right. So I'm going to skip this part because it's just going in depth about what I just said before. And again, that little hint down there is like one of Bill Kinney's little anecdotes. And Bill Kinney goes into his speech. He always uses the Libby boxes. It's funny. He skips over the Kinney 3 real quick, but he goes to Libby boxes. Dr. Libby is a professor at Cornell, and he came up with this predictive validity framework called the Libby boxes. All right? It's really talking about the underlying constructs between your objectives and the measures. I'll let you guys read that. Again, this is just kind of going to give you insight about next week. Don't worry, we don't have any models in this class, but for some of you guys who are learning, like, you learn better by thinking of things in like X's and Y's. Y's are dependent, right? That's the phenomenon to be explained. X is your theory about what causes Y. You can't forget prior causes of Y, right? So you have to have those V's in there. And then Z is some of the exogenous kind of things that you need to control for. It'll make sense once I show you this, all right? So this is a Libby box. Oh, there's one more. This is how it all fits together, all right? So we have a conceptual, a research question, high level. We think that auditor experience affects audit quality. Audit experience, audit quality. But that's not how you actually operationalize those variables. You have to get specific. What do you mean by audit experience? How do you define that? That's what it means by operationalizing, right? So, well, non-audit related fees, right? Well, how do you define lower quality financial reporting? Well, a restatement, right? So these are my actual variables. And then things that could possibly influence this relationship, industry size, audit policies, acquisitions, et cetera, right? So these are all just hints for what you guys need to do for, and again, I'll give this to Chaz, so she can give this to you guys as well. What you guys have to do for next week, right, is to come up with a research question, right? A JDM, judgment decision making research question, that relates to information technology or AIS, right? And you need to, you're gonna have to give Dr. Brown LeBird and myself the Kenny 3 paragraphs before next week. We'll have Chow send out the email on when that particular thing is due, all right? You're gonna have to come up with the Libby boxes of your idea, right? And then you're gonna present your idea next week, right? Manners, right? So during that presentation, you're basically having, I don't know how much time that she wanted to give us, but so plan on having it about 10 minutes, and again, we'll give you the details when we send out the email to Chow. So the two of you need to come up. It's probably a good idea if you have PowerPoints. You're gonna explain your research idea, what it is, why you think it's important, right? And then what do you, right now, obviously without doing a lot of research, how do you think you could do it? How would you actually test your research idea? Would you build an experiment with different conditions? Describe it, all right? And you have about 10 minutes or so to do that. Again, more details to come later. Obviously, as a PhD student, I appreciate when I have it in writing as well. And FYI, you probably should plan on Helen and I asking you questions, right? As you're up here, right? Why do you think that this is a good JDM topic? What's the judgment that the auditor or the person involved in this would have to make? Why do you think that these particular group of people would care about this? Who affects, you know? So be prepared to elaborate on that Kenny brief, right? What's your question? Why is it important? And within why is it important? To who? Who is it important to? Right? Auditors, instructors. Maybe it's a classroom question. How do you teach data analytics? Should it be an auditing classroom? So that is what you should plan on doing for next week.